That is going to be it. Monsoon is going to take the game. Tournament attendee MVP.
Because I was sick this week, I actually haven't been practicing with my warrior pretty much at all.
Pinpingho, all that big talk, but he's going to have to climb out from quite the deficit.
He was pretty crazy.
That is more than enough, way more than enough for Pinpingho to do it. And we are going to go to game five. Pinpingho ties up the series.
In the end, I hope to win with my warrior in the mirror match.
It's going to go for it. Stinkmaster time. Stinkmaster time. He's got to hit the Aseri. He's got to turn into a 1-1.
Here we go.
Does he do it, Matson?
He's not happy with it. And it turns his Anubarak into a squirrel. And that is going to be it. Pinpingho.
Oh, man. Pinpingho has won this match in a thrilling 3-2 victory.
I'm feeling really good, and I think maybe I'm the chosen one with all this crazy RNG. Yes, I'm pretty sure it's my destiny that I'm gonna win this. To my future opponent, prepared to witness the power of the chosen one. I'll bring you more exciting match tomorrow.
The Chosen One. We could be on the verge of witnessing greatness. TJ, are you launching?
I'm excited because prepare to witness the power of the Chosen One. Oh my goodness. Pinpingho never fails.
I love this
to
guy.
Deliver.
Can I just put it out there? I think Pinpingho delivers the best interviews in Hearthstone, and he completely owns it. It's great. Welcome back, everybody, to the Winter Championship Desk. It's time to begin the semifinals. My name is Frody. I'm joined by TJ Ozum and Cutie Sanders. And once again, we're going to be delighted to bring you who is going to be going to the finals, the first between these two players of Dahyoni versus Pinpingho.
Yeah, it's going to be a great matchup. Pinpingho, he's had some struggles in his matches, but somehow he keeps coming out on top. And Dahyoni was sort of touted as, you know, one of the best players to come out of Korea. And a lot of players were hyping up the Korean players in this tournament, saying this was theirs to win. So really looking forward to this one.
Let's go ahead and look at the upcoming polls. The way you can get involved in it is to hashtag Dahyoni or hashtag Pinpingho by using HCT, excuse me. You know, we won't be able to see the vote without using HCT, so make sure to include it in some of your tweets as well as your posts. I know a lot of people are starting to poll for Pinpingho. He's a lot of the chat champion, you know. People are saying, like, oh, Pinpingho, he always keeps saying that he wants to win. Can he do it? But I do know a lot of Korean fans are voting for Dahyoni as well. It's going to be a struggle back and forth. I can't wait to get the series underway, TJ.
Yeah, and it's going to be a really good one. And Pinpingho, he sort of had those tournaments elude him, those tournament wins elude him. So, you know, all chat fandom aside, it's going to be a good matchup.
All right, let's meet our players, beginning with a player from Taiwan, the chosen one. It's Pinpingho.
Pinpingho, known as the Shaman God as at BlizzCon 2015 last year at the World Championship. He didn't bring it, but he's still there.
What's up?
Give it a wave to the crowd.
I'm waving back at
him. Yeah, hello, Pinpingho.
He's from Taoyuan, Taiwan. I love that place. Great food. Night markets are awesome. Pinpingho, he owns it, man. But can he go up against another player who's known to be equally entertaining in his own Korean realm? Is Dahyoni.
And Dahyoni, the winner of the Korea Winter Preliminaries, had some really crazy matchups throughout the preliminaries and had a lot of impressive performances as well. He's a popular streamer, one of the most popular streamers from Korea, and he's here to prove that he's not just an entertainer, he's actually a formidable force in the competitive Hearthstone scene.
Ooh, TJ, being edgy. Streamers can be good at Hearthstone too. T-I-L. Well, Dahyoni, I think he has definitely had a couple of rocky roads to get to this point. He didn't exactly come in first place in the group, but that doesn't matter. It's playoff time. From this point on, Pinpingho could lose his first series, but he'd be out of the tournament. So this is where the rubber meets the road. No series losses from this point on, and you'll become the champion. You know what I'm really excited about? One of these guys is guaranteed a finals berth, TJ. And that means one of the finalists will be an entertaining guy to watch.
Yes, that's definitely true. Both these guys, when they're on camera, they are very emotive. And that's not something that you can say a lot about competitive Hearthstone players. They're usually poker-faced and not really outgoing, but these two players definitely entertaining to watch.
Let's take a look at the polls of what you guys are saying on social media. Who are you guys voting for? Peeping Ho! With a really hot reading right now. That went up just like the thermometer when I'm calling in sick to school in the morning. Wow, that's insane. Just watching the growth goes whoop.
Yeah.
Or actually, in this case, whoop. I don't know, man. Left and right, I'm not a great driver myself, I admit it.
Yeah, Peeping Ho. I'm not surprised to see that he's the Finn favorite coming into this one. But, you know, you have to look at their decks. Both their deck lists are very similar. The big difference here being their Warlock decks.
Yep.
With Dione bringing a Zoo Warlock and Peeping Ho bringing the
Demon Handlock.
Demon Handlock, yeah.
Yep.
And the bans are coming out, and it's going to be the Mage ban from Dione and the Warrior ban from Peeping Ho.
That's so interesting, considering that Peeping Ho has Warrior and Druid, that he's willing to ban Freeze Mage. But he knows that Diaoyu was most likely going to ban the Warrior class, because that's what he's been doing all tournament long. So he says, if I don't feel reliable with Druid and even Murloc pounding against Freeze Mage, I'm just going to strike it. And then meanwhile, take my chances against the rest of his lineup.
Yeah, I think that's a really smart choice. A lot of times players can tunnel on, well, I have Warrior, so I can beat Freeze Mage no matter where it is. But you have to look at your deck lineups as a whole. When looking at what deck to ban. So I really like this strategy from Peeping Ho, not just looking at his own lineup, but looking at what he thinks his opponent's going to ban as well.
Is it going to work out for him? He doesn't want to play against Freeze Mage, but he leaves Druid open. Gyakyoni nodding immediately in game number one. Let's see what he is approving of. Is it a good matchup? It is. Druid versus the Murloc Paladin. If there's one deck that has single-handedly stopped Murloc Paladin from dominating the metagame just a couple of months ago when League of Explorers first came out, it is the mid-range Druid deck that has the Force Nature Savage Roars to end the game.
If there's one deck that stopped a lot of decks from wreaking havoc in competitive play and ladder, it's been the Druid for a long time. Any control decks, it's always there to keep it in check, and Murloc Paladin is sort of the epitome of control decks, so definitely, this is something that Peeping Ho probably thought about banning in his strategy, since he has so many of those slow decks. But it's one of those times where you can give up that loss knowing that you're going to have strong matchups across the rest of the board. But it's still winnable.
All right. Well, Peeping Ho's Murloc Paladin has still been pretty good. In fact, he hasn't lost a single game. However, he's been playing all control matchups. He played against Control Warrior. He played against the Mirrors. The fact that he has cards like Zombie Chow is specifically to seize the early game board. And Peeping Ho, with cards like Zombie Chow, with cards like Doomsayer, is going to be able to try and out-tempo his opponent. Gyakyoni, though, his hand is really awkward. He's got two swipes in the Savage Roar, which can't really do anything.
Yeah, of course, the way that Druid wins this matchup and the way that they win most control matchups that they're favored in is just every turn they play a strong creature, and there's only a limited amount of removal, even though there's a lot of it in control decks. There's a limited amount. And if you ever fall within a certain threshold, you always risk dying from the Force of Nature Savage Roar combo. So,
oh my goodness.
Wow, that's a curve.
Second Chow. Second Chow versus a Druid is not developing. It's not the fact that the Chows even do damage, it's that you're commanding so much board position that you might feel pretty comfortable, and Chows don't do anything in turns 6 onwards. Like, even turn 4 onwards when your opponent's playing Pilot Shredder, you feel like it has low impact.
Yeah, we'll see if he does play the Zombie Chow here. It isn't mana efficient. There is a few arguments here. One for pointing out the Murloc War Leader, but Coin does have some value in this matchup. But also just, you know, hero powering and opening up an opportunity next turn. Play Zombie Chow Hero Power and just really spacing out those early game threats.
Yep. I mean, Peeping Ho just has to make sure to seize the board preemptively. I'm still looking at Chow.
Yeah.
I mean, the reality is you could have a 1-1 or a 2-3. That's just in terms of the sheer tempo on the board.
Yeah.
Mana efficiency is important, but how good does Murloc War Leader get later on in the game compared to Zombie Chow? And I think Zombie Chow ends up being much worse.
Yeah, definitely. Dione, a fantastic draw right there. If he picked up something that he couldn't play,
that was crucial.
And on turn 3, he just hero powered and then passed against a Paladin, against a Murloc Paladin. That would have been, very rough.
That Azure Drake was so big too, being able to play something that wasn't Keeper of the Grove. And now, let's see what Peeping Ho chooses to do here. There's a lot of ways he can go about this. He can choose to remove the Azure Drake, play Muster for battle, or he can choose to play tempo and try to keep his board as strong as possible.
Look at this board from Pimpingo. This is a Murloc Paladin, and he's tempoing the Druid out of the game. Not out of the game yet, but this is a pretty rough situation to be in. He's going to be able to remove some of it. But just having to remove and not being able to play any proactive threats is not where you want to be in this matchup.
Well, I think Dahyoni is still in a really okay spot. The reality is Zombie Chow doesn't actually put real pressure. It just controls the board state. And it's almost, and it feels like a simple oversimplification, but if Dahyoni just gets like two Savage Roars under an Emperor Thorsen reduction, that means he'll always be threatening to kill Murloc Paladin if he just has one minion stick on board.
Yeah.
So I still feel like even though it's a great start, don't feel like it's over. Murloc Paladin has plays, but Dahyoni has responses right now.
Yeah, and playing these early game creatures for the Murloc Paladin means that you're those are one less card for you to have that's part of your combo, part of your win condition. Because just having the board is not the win condition for Murloc Paladin. You need to draw your Murlocs, and eventually we'll need to kill the Druid with anything can happen.
Yeah, and look at this. Ping-Ping-Ho doesn't have a board anymore. He's going to play most likely a Doomsayer and wait for Dahyoni to respond to it. Unless he feels like he wants to seize the board once again with Wild Pyromancer and Bluegill Warrior.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, there is merit to it. He just used two swipes. It's very unlikely that he can swipe with a Pyromancer and Bluegill Warrior, but I still feel like this is better.
Hey, he's going to need some card draw, though, is the big thing. Solemn Vigil, Lay on Hands. Because right now, his hand quality is not very good. Consecration, while paired with an Equality, is a fantastic way to clear even a Druid's board. By itself, it really doesn't do much of anything.
So, Dahyoni, I mean, are you going to silence this Doomsayer? I feel like giving tempo to the Paladin to play anything with up to 8 mana is a little bit scary. You know Ping-Ping-Ho has cards like Dr. Boom in the deck.
Yeah. Just having one creature on the board, even if all it is a Keeper of the Grove, can actually end up being a pretty big deal. Just because it's there to contest, it's there to start building up the board, and you have both Keepers.
Sure.
There's really not many silence targets in this deck.
You know, utilizing the Innervate to put Drew the Claw is okay. Do you want to claw the 1/1 to reduce cards like Solemn Vigil from being even better? Where shall I strike?
Whoa.
Wow, that's pretty aggressive.
That's very aggressive.
Which does end up getting answered by cards like the Bluegill Warrior and the Consecration. Dahyoni's not messing around.
Not at all. And with Savage Roar in the hand, you know, I understand. And he's thinking about this at the same time now, but I'm not sure if it's too relevant. And Claw can also be used as extra burst in combination with Savage Roar for one mana, similar to, you know, Living Roots added onto the end of a combo. Can catch your opponent off guard.
Sure. So. People won't calculate for that. They'll calculate for the Force of Nature Savage Roar very often.
Yeah.
Ping-Ping-Ho, by the way, picks up Murloc War Leader, allowing him to use Bluegill Warrior as 4 damage removal. Looks like he instead is just going to cash it in. Wild Pyromancer, also equally viable. It will do a 3 damage consecration, and you can use his weapon to clear off the last body.
Yeah, he made that play very quickly, and now I think he sees the other line, which...
I think he's fine.
Yeah,
he gets a guaranteed board clear, which is nice.
Yeah.
Before, the other play won't have a board clear, but you still have Consecration, and you still have Pyromancer.
Yeah.
The big thing about this play is that now, if it starts expanding with 5/5s again, then he can't actually use Equality effectively.
Yeah,
he has Bluegill Warrior and Equality.
That's what I was thinking there. Now he just doesn't have an activation, which could end up being a big deal, because a quality Consecrate or a quality Pyromancer is one of the ways that you can stabilize. Oh, there it is!
There you go. I mean, I was saying from the very beginning, even though Ping-Ping-Ho had an early game curve, this matchup is still that bad. Like, Murloc Paladin needs a lot of time to set up. It's still a turn away from anything can happen, which most likely means Ping-Ping-Ho has to set that up. Murloc War Leader, Bluegill Warrior, attack the face. However, there is a small window of opportunity. I just don't feel, I'm not feeling it. Dahyoni has Savage Roar, and he just needs to pick up Force of Nature, and he even kills him next turn.
Yeah. He's, Pimpingo's on a very short clock here, and the amount of cards that he needs to piece together in order to find a win is pretty immense. He needs card draw on top of, you know, more Murlocs, on top of board clear, because he'll need to clear the board, draw cards, and then he'll need to find a way to play both Anything Can Happen to close out the game. So it's really not looking good. And having to expend pretty much his whole hand over the next two turns just to kill, you know, one or two creatures is not where he wants to find himself.
Here's a hilarious thing. Even if Ping Ping Ho played super duper safe and played Consecration with the coin on that, like to keep his health a little, even if he drew Force of Nature, he's still dead because there's two Savage Roars and an Innervate.
Yeah.
Dahyoni most likely just going to try to fish as hard as he can, and then he can just play Emperor Thorsen. Pimpingho does have access to anything the following turn, though. So, I mean, maybe it's this realm of possibility that.
But there hasn't really. I mean, how many Murlocs have been played? Isn't just two War Leaders and a Bluegill Warrior?
Oh, you're right. Murkai hasn't been played.
Yeah, Murkai has not been played, so anything can happen right now is super weak.
I think maybe you can pray for an Anything Can Happen, and then maybe number two comes out. No, but then you only have two Bluegill Chargers
out.
Yeah,
then you still don't have Murkai.
With four, so that ends up being 16 damage only, and you're still far away.
Like I said, he needs like eight cards in his deck in the next two turns, or he's dead.
Dahyoni ends up taking it really slow, leaving the Murloc War Leader alive. Which means there is a shred of hope. He's going to play Anything Can Happen. He also can consider killing the War Leader. I guess it's still relatively inconsequential. Ooh. Okay. Awkward. I think Pimpingho realized that he missed two damage there.
Not even being the chosen one can save you from that one.
not quite deity status yet.
Yeah.
We'll have to see if Dahyoni just ends the game right here. He gets a. Oh, I saw some trees. Not the
That's
kind
of
trees
a lot
he
of
wants.
Trees.
It's a lot of plants. It's a lot of nature stuff. Not quite it, though. Living Roots. Plus Keeper, plus Claw. I mean, that's still a lot of damage. It's like 12 damage just in stuff alone.
You can
Nourish just to draw Force of Nature.
Yeah. That's three cards.
Wait.
And Force of Nature is like the next card. So.
Oh, man. Wait, he still has it, doesn't he? Hold on. Oh, no, sorry. He has 5 mana. I thought he had 7 mana. Yeah. So I was like, if he has 7 mana, he still could just Innervate Force of Nature and then use Living Roots and end the game.
But it's pretty much over the next turn, because even if Pimpingho draws into Lay on Hands, he'll go back up to 23 health, and we can see that there's going to be a creature on the board even after that. He's making sure that he clears the Murloc War Leader, so setting up for an automatic lethal next turn.
And a second Anything Can Happen would mean he has 16.
Yeah.
Oh, man. The Murkai comes just a little bit too late. You know, there was a shred of hope. A single shred of hope. It wasn't out of the realm of possibility for Pimpingho to win this game. He had a really good early game curve. He played the removal game and controlled the state of the board. In the end, though, Druid's Force of Nature Savage Roar just too much.
Yeah. Wait, with the second Anything, I think the second Anything would have been lethal damage. There would have been 20 damage, right? Just with the two Bluegills and four War Leaders?
That's 16 damage. And he would have three on board preemptive.
He would have four War Leaders.
Right, but so
two Bluegills.
Two Bluegills would be 16.
Okay.
Right. That's what I was saying.
Yeah.
He didn't have actually enough because there was nothing on board.
Yeah. Still a shred of hope. But like you said, that's just sort of what happens in this matchup. Just super tough for the Murloc Paladin, even with a good start. And you know, some people might not even call that a good start. Zombie Chows are great, but he didn't draw a single cycle spell that entire game. No Lay on Hands, no Solemn Vigil. And that's not what you want to see, because you need to get deeper in that deck.
All right, well, that's going to wrap up the first game. Pimpingho, he's still can definitely take down other classes, but Druid was Gyahuni's best pick by a pretty big margin. When you have Demon Handlock, when you have things like the Murloc Paladin, those are both very susceptible to Druid. So I think it's similar to the Navi strategy of just like, look, this is going to win a game. I'm just going to let it go.
Yeah. Yeah, that's and that's a sometimes a necessary thing to do. So he's probably happy that it's out of the way in the first game, and now is the meaty part. And Pipico was pretty vocal in his interview yesterday about how his lineup is good against Control Warrior. And that's just how it is. And his lineup is good against very specific decks. So reverse sweeps with Pimpico should are going to be pretty common if he's going to make it further in this tournament. A semifinal or a finals berth on the line. This is semifinal number one. So lots for these players to think about. And not too animated for these guys so far as well.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. They're relatively calm given the situation, but I think that's where you got to be. Just phase everything out and hope for the best. Murloc Paladin versus the Zoo Warlock. TJ, how are you feeling about this matchup these days?
To be honest, I actually really like the Zoo Warlock in this matchup, but the one that I have the more experience with it is the Sea Giant version, the version that came out of China from a player named Duke. It runs in Hanso Mikano, Sea Giants, and Leroy Jenkins as a finisher. This version that Dionys running runs Doom Guards, which are better in certain matchups, one of them being Druid, because it fights for the board better. And overall, Doom Guards just a stronger minion than Leroy Jenkins in general, and easier to push out if you're willing to give up the downside of two cards than Sea Giant is. So this version is a little bit weaker to the Murloc Paladin, but Zoo Warlocks can reload the board really easily, and they can put on a lot of pressure at the same time, which is one thing that Murloc Paladins don't deal with well.
Yeah, but Pimpio has some of the key cards. He's got weapon removal, he's got consecration, he even has Wild Pyromancer and the Equality, which guarantees to clear at least the first wave of the minions.
Yeah.
Sometimes Nerubian Eggs and Haunted Creepers introduce a weird problem with that, though.
Doomsayer can be pretty good as well. Just to, at the very least, block 7 damage, so.
Yeah, feels excellent in this position. Your opponent has to generate a little bit more than 2 damage. 2 damage seems to be the easy increments. Defender of Argus, Abusive Sergeant, Direwolf Alpha. Those things help give +2 damage to the board, but Daphne needs to find 3. Therefore, he might have to gamble on an implosion. Well, or he can concede. He can concede the fact that... No, sorry, not concede the game.
Concede the game. that's always an option, Dan. Conceding is always an option.
I would not recommend conceding the game, but he can also concede the fact that Doomsayer will pop, life tap, and cut his losses accordingly.
Yeah, so if he rolls a 3, he'll be able to kill it, so...
What are the odds?
The average two result...
2 out of 3, he'll kill it. Oh... Yeah.
He got it.
I mean, that was a scary moment. You could see that his heart was palpitating. Pipico was like, I wasn't really optimistic about it anyways. Because, Power of Overwhelming is a possibility that he could lose it too. So, not the worst thing for Pipico. And Consecration here, excellent because of how it forces Daihoni to implosion, and now he can't use it anymore.
Yeah, and just stifling the board is the key here for the Murloc Paladin. Over and over again.
Only that was a Solemn Vigil that was drawn. Would have been crazy.
Yeah. Would have been able to play it for free.
Mm-hmm.
But like I said, this is one of the strengths of the Zoo Warlock is they can keep reloading, keep applying the pressure.
But I still feel like Pimpingho's in a pretty decent spot because Diahuni went for a more mana-efficient play, which is perfectly reasonable.
Yeah.
Choose Over Champion can now hit the Knife Juggler, where before, if he was playing the Void Walker, he'd be in a little bit more awkward situation. However, I mean, the mana efficiency makes sense. Diahuni can play Void Walker and Defender of Argus next turn and dump his hand before Doomguard discards too many cards.
Yeah. And once again, Doomguard, while... it does do well in a lot of more board-centric matchups. A lot of times it's hard to get it out without the downside. But still could be used. Pipico's options here, basically you can True Silver Champion, or you can try and play more board-oriented with the Eldar Peacekeeper, but...
I'd be pretty surprised if he goes for the Peacekeeper, because it feels like you can get punished super easily with the fact that you don't actually address the Knife Juggler.
Yeah.
So if he gets one single juggle, that 2-1 can punish you on the Spectral Spider side.
Yeah.
So I think Pimpingo is just considering possibilities, but the upside of developing Choose Over Champion far outweighs any other option here. Okay, Nerubian Egg is insurance.
Yeah, against that area of effect. One thing you need to make sure that you do in this matchup, though, is tap whenever possible. And Doomguard makes that a little bit awkward because it means you're more likely to discard something important later down the road when you have to play the Doomguard. But you need to be able to have the quantity of cards to keep reloading the board. And I really like how Dione's doing this here. He's sort of mixing pressure with that insurance of the Nerubian Egg. Make sure he doesn't put all of his eggs in one basket.
Ah! Oh, TJ, there it is. I was waiting for your pun game to come out. You are indeed a worthy opponent. I need some time to think, though. Pimpingo, he draws the Bluegill Warrior, which was a great draw. So that way he doesn't feel obligated to play a little bit awkwardly. He can now remove the Direwolf Alpha and then play another minion. Oh, he's getting a quality here. Okay.
This is a full board clear. So I can understand it, but it's with the Bluegill Warrior, it wasn't going to be that strong of a board. If he had, you know, cleared the two creatures, he could have been left with just a 1-1 on the board and the unpopped egg.
Okay.
And, you know, be able to hero power or even put the Wild Pyromancer into play if he so chose. But this line means that if you're popping the egg proactively, it means that your opponent's not getting value out of cards like Abusive Sergeant or Power Overwhelming or Defender of Argus. You're not giving them that opportunity. So sometimes that can be the better play. And I know a lot of players will think, oh, he never popped the egg. It gives him a 4-4. Sometimes it's good.
But the egg's not really a threat until it actually is a threat.
Yeah.
That's what I feel. And if he...
My mind just exploded.
We need not to fear Nerubian eggs, but the Nerubian itself, TJ. A great president once said. Or a mayor of Valuetown, I'm not sure. The thing about it is now you don't have a quality. I guess you do have Bluegill Warrior to act as damage, so to speak. No different than, you know, an arcane shot or a holy smite if you can translate that damage accordingly.
Yeah.
Okay, so he plays Peacekeeper and he plays Doomsayer. I felt like Doomsayer was still good enough because if your opponent had a Power Overwhelming,
yeah,
he would just commit all of it onto the Doomsayer. But I guess in this situation, he says, I really want to make sure Power Overwhelming can't kill a Doomsayer.
Yeah. Also, the turn before you play Lay on Hands, especially before turn 8, you want to make sure the board's as clean as possible. Reason being is because when you're spending your whole turn healing and drawing cards, you're giving all of the initiative over to your opponent. So being able to play that on a clean board sort of buys you time.
Ooh. Dahuni ditches two of his more expensive cards there. Definitely didn't want to lose the Defender of Argus. Explosion's still okay. And now Pimpingo really needs to hope that he draws a way to deal with this Doomguard. Whether it's a quality, whether it's an ability to neuter its damage. Okay, True Silver Champion's reasonable.
Those are some really good draws, actually.
Yeah, fantastic draws.
Because all of those sort of allow him to fight for the board, or most of them sort of allow him to fight for the board. But Dione's got some good draws for himself.
I think it was inevitable, considering that he drew some of a lot of his other cards, too. And Dr. Boom is his top end for sure. I think he's wondering if there's any possibility of playing something else, and I don't think it is. You play Dr. Boom, you play him now, and you go face. All the way. I mean, realistically, you might even have damage to kill him the following turn.
Yeah.
Murloc War Leaders, Murkai, Bluegill Warrior, you can play all of them. That is 9 damage of removal.
Okay.
12 if you count the Peacekeeper.
Bear with me, Dan. Is there a world here where you race?
Let me think.
Oh, interesting.
True Silver Champion provides 8 damage over 2 turns. So that would mean you have to piece together 12. Murloc War Leader, Bluegill Warrior, and Old Murkai.
Is 9.
That's
something worth considering, but I think you're also afraid of just dying to the simplest of buffs, and you haven't seen Power Overwhelming. It is a really interesting question, TJ.
You get a
gold star for today's Hearthstone
class. If he had played True Server Champion, just smacked face with the Aldor Peacekeeper and gone face with the creatures, he would have done 12 damage this turn.
Right.
He would have been lethal.
And he did discard a Defender of Argus with the Doomguard.
Yeah.
I don't know. With Dark Peddler and Beast of Sergeant, though, it feels like he just would have died.
Yeah. There would have been 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 damage with Abusive Sergeant. Boombots can make for some interesting plays, and Dark Peddler Auras can pick up some crazy stuff. So,
okay, let's see what Daihoni pulls here. By the way, I think he is cognizant of the fact that he might die to it. Anything can happen. I don't know. Flame Imp's a great minion, but you're lowering yourself from 12 to 9 health? It seems suspect, to say the least.
Yeah. Daihoni really likes those Blood Imps. It's the second time that he's chosen Blood Imp.
Over, like, a lowly squire?
Over, insert miscellaneous one drop that doesn't have stealth. I think he chose over Reliquary Seeker yesterday, or day one, and then you see him choose it over the lowly squire this time around.
Mm-hmm. Well, it looks like he's going to try to boom bot and kill off everything here. Has to move a little bit quickly. Oh, chooses to do 5 damage. I guess it doesn't really matter. It comes down to whether or not Pimping Ho can draw and anything can happen.
Well, keep him alive? He can go up to 15. That's if he smacks face. There might be some merit. The board's full.
It won't be totally full because of the Peacekeeper, though. So there is 5, 10 damage represented on the board alone, and you go up to 15 with the upside of Boombots and Knife Juggler. The reality is, if you draw one single, anything can happen, though. You still win the game,
yeah.
Right? So I think you still play a board control orient.
I was going to say, you could also go for the old the old Wild Power Mancer muster for battle play.
Yeah, clear off some of the creatures. Play. It's one of my favorites. I don't mind going face here, but I do kill. I do want to consider killing the Knife Juggler so he can't get additional damage.
Yeah.
This is a pretty heads-up play too, for Pimping Ho to sequence his muster for battle before, so that way he can increase as many targets as possible for Boombot to not hit face. I think you gotta go for this attack. You can't let Knife Juggler. Oh, he's gonna let it. Oh, Daihoni. He realizes his opening.
All right. What?
Lotheb. Interesting. Now he can't play anything. Can happen.
What? What makes you go face there? Let's break this down a little bit. There's nothing in his deck that he could set up for potential lethal unless he drew second Consecrate and Daihoni also tapped.
Right. That's the primary thing.
Which is very unlikely. But Pimping Ho's thinking, Pimping Ho's thinking, hey, maybe I just make it so that that's not an option for him.
Right. And also, because that attack, he's indirectly forcing Daihoni to trade into his board, which is another consequence of being super aggressive. I know players like Firebat really love attacks like what we just saw.
Yeah.
Because that is a super difficult attack to make.
Yeah.
And Pimping Ho is able to call it. I mean, he's playing pretty well, all things considered. A lot of people might be feeling otherwise, but now what do? You can't play spells. Well, sorry.
Ooh.
You can't play that spell. And expect to do anything else.
He can Solemn Vigil and see what he would have got.
Oh, I wouldn't want to do that. My heart couldn't take it. That's a 2-0 lead for Daihoni, putting himself on match point to be the first finalist in the Asia Pacific region.
Yeah.
What do you think about that?
But Pimping Ho has been in this situation before. Just yesterday, in fact, where he was down 0-2 and came back to win the whole series. So don't count him out yet, but Daihoni has proven himself to be one of the strongest players so far in the Asia Pacific Winter Championship. So,
And all he has to do is win one more game with his warrior, which Pimping Ho is isolating out. He has his own druid, he has his own paladin, he has his own warlock, and he's going to be targeting the warrior. But even if you have a 60% favorite against the matchup each time, you still have a losing percentage overall in the series because he still gets that many chances. So you just do 60% times 60%, and it gets actually kind of low, at least mathematically. Now, crazier things have happened, TJ, such as 2 games where 4 warriors have come out and 3 chargers end up not killing the control warrior.
The odds of that happening is very low. The odds of it happening twice
in
the span of 2 days is even lower.
Yeah. Yeah, TJ. That's why we get. That's why you pay you the big bucks to bring insightful commentary like that. JK, man, I actually said the same exact thing.
You're welcome.
Why did they put us two together, TJ? We're just redundant at this point.
Yeah.
These two, like two players come into this, one player goes to the finals, two casters come in here, only one of us is going to the finals. Oh, man. Let's go into game number three and see whether or not Pimping Hill can make the comeback. He did it yesterday against a Japanese player. He's going to need your energy. We're going to start things off with Paladin versus Warrior. And I'm sure Dahuni, if he hasn't understood how to play the matchup before, he certainly does.
Yeah.
Now that he's watched players like Navi play it to perfection.
Yep. We talked about Pinpinko coming back from 0-2, and the deck that he did it against was Control Warrior. He even said it in his interview. He said, "My lineup is targeted at Control Warrior," knowing that a lot of players were going to bring it. So, smart move. Pinpinko also quoted as saying, "I don't have to be the best. I'm going to win anyway."
Yeah, he was also quoted saying that he is the chosen one. And I don't know if it would... I don't know if the chosen one's supposed to die before the finals. It would be a really good plot twist. But it'd be one that I don't know if I'd be happy with. Sometimes TV shows just have plot twists for the sake of it.
Yeah.
And you know, and it's oftentimes not a very good ending. If Pipiho truly is the main character, the MC, if you will, he needs to stay alive. Otherwise, it's probably the worst anime I've ever watched.
He loses, the show's canceled.
Dahuni, he's not going to be able to play much for the first two turns, but he has the Acolyte of Pain straight into the muster for battle. Now that his opponent has used a coin, he knows it's safe.
Yeah.
Oh no. Dahuni has drawn a Battle Rage, and that is not the card in his deck. In fact, that is... is something else. It looks like we have a little bit of misstep. He's just going to contact the admin real quick. Unless I'm mistaken. Unless he has a Battle Rage in his deck, and I'm just not sure.
Maybe he doesn't even remember.
Well, thankfully, I have a piece of technology. Either way, the Acolyte of Pain would enable a lot of draws off of these 1-1 tokens, which means he gets access to a lot of resources. He already has the Sludge Belcher and Brawl. And so if he gets access to the Justicar True Heart, it would be crazy.
Yeah.
So Pimping Ho is already stressed. Oh my god, he has an Acolyte of Pain. Does he have to use a quality on this?
You know, it's not the worst thing. We saw almost this identical situation yesterday, I think, where I'm not sure if it was Pimping Ho or another player using a quality just to deny two draws.
Okay, looks like Pimping Ho going to play the Murloc War Leader. However, we are going to be jumping out of the game momentarily just to get everything fixed. Apologies on our ends. Now that we see the early game plays, though, it could have been a pretty big deciding factor. I think one of the things in control matchups that people always say is that card draw matters a ton because optimal removal matters so much. And if you need an example, look at the previous series with Matsune versus Naviut, where he was able to get a really effective amount of board out, and then Matsune was just so awkward with removing because he didn't have the optimal shield slams with the executes.
Yeah. And you got to make sure that you have those things. You can get into a situation, especially against Murloc Paladin, where you're forced to use those key cards that you need for your win condition, like Brawl and Sludge Belcher. You're forced to use them early just to try and stop the pressure, just to try and stop the bleeding. Mm-hmm. So those are the situations that you don't want to find yourself in. You want to make sure that you get that cycle. You cycle through your deck and have that just card on time and be able to use your removal sparingly to set yourself up for that win condition.
It's true. And now that Dahuni will have the opportunity to play that Control Warrior, I mean, can it beat Druid and Murloc Paladin? It definitely can. I think a lot of people are also looking at the matchups like the Druid and wondering how good is Druid against Warrior these days. And if you ask a lot of the Warrior players, they're actually getting much more optimistic about it. They feel like Warrior's not too bad against what Druid can provide. So I'm not even feeling like Dahuni's in an overwhelming favorite, but I still feel like he's in a position where it's like, yeah, he still has a very good chance of taking the series.
Yeah, I think this matchup is the most important though, because this is
the most winnable.
Yeah, the most winnable. And it's also sort of the the highlight matchup of the entire event, because it's so many players being Control Warrior, so many players being Murloc Paladin. Even talking with players from other regions prior to this week, coming into the Asia-Pacific Championship, I'm sure everybody was thinking, hey, Murloc Paladin comes out on top, and that's why you bring it. You bring it because you know that people are going to bring Control decks, but it's sort of fallen flat in its face, and now that Control Warrior players know how to beat it, it's been figured out now. It's faltering.
Okay, well, I can't disagree there, because the results have shown that Paladin and the Warrior have been back and forth. It's not been it's actually kind of split down the middle. We've had slightly more Warriors beat the Paladins, but we've also had Paladin beats Warriors just as often, a little bit less actually. So can't really argue with those statistics. I do feel like it's kind of funny that Ping Ping Ho's Warrior got banned in the context of what Daohyun Yu did bring, because he did have some classes that I feel like were good against the Warrior.
Yeah.
I think he was afraid of his Freeze Mage being left open.
Yeah.
So if his Freeze Mage was left open and he didn't ban the Warrior, because these bans are made in Blind Pig format, it would have been the case. Because not only does the strategy work better for Daohyun Yu if Warrior's in the lineup, but also the fact that Ping Ping Ho says he's not very good with the Warrior deck right now, and it's his worst performing deck by far. He has like a 30% win rate right now with it in the tournament.
You can really tell that Daohyun Yu expected a Druid ban.
Yeah,
he made his ban based off of the Druid ban, and that's sort of looking at your own decks against your opponents instead of looking at your own decks and your opponent's previous ban strategy. So, I think Ping Ping Ho got the better of Daohyun Yu, at least in the pick ban phase of the matchup. But, you know, still got to play it out. Ping Ping Ho is down 0-2 and moving once again into game number three here, the Murloc Paladin versus Control Warrior.
Oh, yeah. You said a lot of things that made me happy, TJ. Pick ban phase. We're really esports now. Ping Ping Ho is going to start things off with the good old hero power, and his hand is looking pretty similar to last game, honestly. He's got the Murloc War Leader and the True Silver Champion. This time around, though, Daohyun Yu does have the weapons, which could make a huge difference in stopping Ping Ping Ho from building any kind of pressure.
And Jessakar Trueheart is also
huge
in the hand from Daohyun Yu. That is the most important card to have in most control matchups, especially this one. You need to start building up the armor total early. You need to get, I think the sweet spot's around 50 is what we've seen players survive with. 70 allows you to play around like worst case scenarios. 70 plus.
So it's, oh my gosh. And then of course 80 onwards means you just won't lose, right?
Yeah. 100 means your opponent DC'd.
And you're just refusing to end the game, so you just keep tanking up.
Yeah.
I mean, I've seen some crazy screenshots of people getting in the thousands of armor, TJ. Do you have the artifact? Daohyun Yu gonna play the Star Seeker. Map to the Golden Monkey, not that relevant, but the important thing is having some minion to fight back.
Yeah. The Golden Monkey in this matchup is used exclusively to be a mere opponent once you've already won.
The victory cigar?
Yeah, that's what it is. That is exactly what it is.
It's my favorite use of the monkey, honestly.
A lot of times you can't afford to turn your deck into legendaries because you need very specific cards to win. We've talked about it over the past couple of days, Belcher and Brawl being the two main ones.
Well, he's got the Sludge points. Belcher. He also has the ability to just coin a Justicar Trueheart. And he ends up going for it, realizing he needs to get that life total up from the beginning. And Ping Ping Ho has to get to work.
Come on and slam the Jessica Trueheart.
Okay. I was thinking, like, Ping Ping Ho has slam in his deck, and I was pretty confused.
Nope.
You can't say things like that, TJ. All dilly-willy, expecting me not to take it seriously. You're such a serious guy, TJ.
You should know me by now, Dan.
I don't know you at all. You've changed, man. You used to be like so into Control Warrior. Nowadays, all you play is Patron.
I'm so sorry.
TJ pretends like he's like a Control Warrior enthusiast. So many people who play Warrior are like, oh yeah, I love Control Warrior, so great. But TJ, all he plays is Patron Warrior. I know him. I see him. I have him on my friends list. One of my three friends.
have gone to the dark side. Control Warrior is still one of the most interesting decks in the game. Right now, its power level is, you know, through the roof. We saw Amnesiac at the America's Championship run it in his lineup.
And you still don't play it. You play the Patron Warrior. I know you, TJ.
I still don't play it.
You can't fool me.
I also like to go against the grain. Okay, Dan?
Sure. I don't have a problem with it.
I'm a warrior hipster. I'm always thinking a step ahead.
All right. Well, but, what step is Daihoni thinking about then?
I don't know.
I think at this moment, he's taking a lot of damage.
Yeah.
He actually isn't at a very comfortable life total at all. And the fact that Pimping Ho baited out the Whirlwind from the Death Spite before Dr. Boom gets played is a pretty significant fact of this game. However, Daihoni does have a Shield Slam, so that is a redeeming factor here.
Yeah, we talked about Pinping Ho's version of the Murloc Paladin. That's more board-centric. It's got the Monster for Battles. It's got the Shielded mini-boss. It's got Dr. Boom. So it really can apply pressure early, and that's one of the things that does well against this Control Warrior deck, is you pressure them early. You don't give them a chance to build up that huge life total. And yeah, you're right, Dionysus, he's below 30 health.
Which is, you know, I mean, we're kind of giggling at that, but it's a real concern. You know, so we're giggling about it, but it's an actual concern. I feel like we're caught in a recursive loop, TJ. We need to actually get it together, man. Come on. We're at the semifinals. Sludge Belcher, you don't want to play it before the brawls. So you want to equip it, but I mean, these Boombots will start chipping away. Daihoni even willingly cuts the Boombot, chops it in half, and reveals that 3 damage is taken to his face. Ouch.
Well, there's both anything can happen, but there's still quite a few Murlocs that need to be played before Pinping Ho can start to play those and start going for the win.
We've seen 2 Murlocs, I believe. The Bluegill Warrior and the Murloc War Leader.
Murloc War Leader.
So that's a whopping 4 damage off the Anyfin, followed by a 12 damage burst. Not really what you're looking for. However, it's like you said, sometimes, okay, we've been seeing a lot of these games go to fatigue every single time, meaning that we can see all 30 cards. However, we haven't seen a game where the Anyfins can happen twice in a row before we even reach like the 25th card. Like, it usually gets earlier than that.
Yeah. The reason why everybody coming into this tournament was saying Murloc Paladin's favor against Warrior is because in every other situation besides the one we've seen, Murloc Paladin comes out on top.
Yeah, and the Paladins have beaten the Warriors too in this tournament. Even though we highlight the moments where it doesn't, because the anything can happen is so ridiculous.
Yeah.
That only 3 Chargers come out and 4 War Leaders take up the board space.
Like Jessikar Trueheart being in the bottom 10 cards, which actually isn't that unlikely, can make this matchup completely different. You know, all of the Murlocs being in the top 20 cards, which we haven't seen this tournament either, could also make this matchup completely different. So there's a lot of things that need to be considered when talking about this matchup in particular.
Oh, what? That is sexy.
Whoa.
Listen, I think Brian Kibler is on break right now, but he is jumping up and doing the monkey dance right now.
It's hard to see, but I can see his eyebrows right now moving up and down repeatedly.
Kibler wasn't dancing before, but now he is. Right on cue. But there's no camera around, so he's a little bit disappointed. Pimping Ho has an opportunity to shut down this True Silver Champion, or sorry, shut down the Acolyte with the True Silver Champion tonight draws, and I think that's still pretty relevant because even though it's like your game plan isn't dictated upon what your opponent's threats are, the fact is you want him to have less options to remove your board. Yeah. Like, don't have, if he has a revenge, don't pick it up. Okay. Well, you have to pick up the revenge, so.
Yeah.
Not the happiest of situations for Pimping Ho.
I don't think Deathwing even matters. Pretty sure it's just completely unplayable.
If he doesn't draw a brawl.
But you need to play the Belcher after the brawl no matter what.
How about if he has 1 brawl and he plays 2, anything can happen? He plays Deathwing. I'm serious.
Okay. Yeah.
Right? Because the whole point is,
I think you still need the second Belcher, though.
The difference between a combo like Freeze Mage is that they're spells, but anything can happen. If the second one sticks, it's doing 40 damage plus twice. if you let it survive, and you only can remove like three, even if you remove three of them, it's still like 20 some damage coming in your way. So it's the reality is the Deathwing might, with a capital M, which grammatically doesn't make sense, but you get the emphasis, TJ. It might be relevant.
Yeah. Deathwing might be relevant. Capitalized every single word, the beginning of every single word.
Dahuni's playing Sylvanas, which is interesting. I'm actually very surprised that Dahuni didn't revenge and choose to tank up. And again, he's sacrificing a lot of his health pool. And I'm finding a way that he can rationalize it. The only way I can see it is that he wants to get aggressive with the Grommash Hellscream.
Yeah. I'm sort of wondering what the rest of the cards that we haven't seen yet from Dahuni in this particular deck are, because it is a pretty tight list. A lot of times you don't have the ability to run multiple threats outside of Grom Hellscream in the current versions of Control Warrior. And he's got Sylvanas and Deathwing.
Yeah, I have to imagine that he doesn't have the Deathlord side of it.
Yeah.
Dahuni pretty unhappy to see Sylvanas go down to 1 HP because now the Whirlwind will effectively kill it. Oh, I guess he's just going to trade into it right afterwards. That's fine, too.
Saving some life total at the end of the day.
I still don't feel comfortable playing any of these zombies, Chaos. Yeah, I like holding on to it. Okay, Brawl number one being discovered here. Dahuni's going so aggressive. Look at this.
I like this.
He's going hard in the paint. To the dome.
He smells the grand finals. Whatever the grand finals smells like, he wants it.
Well, Pippiho has an answer with the Alder Peacekeeper, so it's not exactly guaranteed. Dahuni goes aggressive. We've seen so many times this matchup being played from an extremely passive point of view. This is incredibly interesting to me. And I don't know if it's gonna work out, but I'm excited.
Yeah.
Because he's saying, if you can't answer my stuff, maybe I'll just win before that. Is he gonna play the Golden Monkey and just throw all caution to the wind, just say, I'm just gonna try to win right now? Alright, he's gonna go for the Sludge Belcher instead.
Well, that also means that he's starting to, you know, give up that plan of going for the late game.
I don't mind it if it works out. I mean, one of the situations is the reality is you don't have to be in this defensive position. Dahuni is a man, and he is going to seize the Murloc by the horns.
Yes, he is. Oh, a quality Consecrate is drawn, but still, Pimpingo needs those Murlocs. And
dude, I love this.
If Dahuni does what I think he's going to do, and that's slam the monkey, then Pimpingo's going to be in trouble because he's out of healing. And even just the monkey alone is a 6-6 body. So
there's several legendaries that can also help Dahuni close out the game. If he picks up Ragnaros, for example, if he picks up King Crush. These are all possibilities that he can get.
He even takes the 3 damage.
Willingly. He's completely underestimating the fact that Dahuni is going to audible here, call a completely different play instead of all defense into offense. Wow, hold on. He's got 5. He can put him at 3. Do you want to bash before you Golden Monkey? If you Golden Monkey, you can win right now with Leroy, and I would love to see that.
Are there any other legendaries that would just win the game on the spot?
I don't know, and he played 2 Zombie Chows, meaning that your health total is very safe. He is so tempted right now
to just drop
the Golden Monkey.
At this point, you have to. You've given up your Belcher. Pippigo's only played 2 Murlocs.
Yeah. Well, he's played in the quality too. He's gonna bash first and then Golden Monkey, and then he's gonna be really sad when Leroy Jenkins. Let's do it. He's got 3 mana, so he can play Van Cleef or whatever he wants. Some
Nat
of the Bane Sisters,
Lore Walker Cho.
Dahuni got his ticket to the Asia Pacific Finals through the Golden Monkey. Will it be his ticket to the finals? I bet it's not bad.
I'd say it's pretty good. Tashi's okay as well. All right, well, we do have another Murloc. But does Pimpingo have time?
Wait, Toshley can get... Oh, he's going to use the Consecration. All right. Toshley can get the Timer Winder, and I was anticipating an opportunity to use it on Grommash. Which, by the way, he's been through a lot in his life. He went from enraged to a law-abiding citizen to...
Oh, man.
Suffering from equality.
This is going to be twice. This is going to come down to the wire, I think, Dan.
Nah, he's just going to rip something. I'm feeling it.
All right.
Reno Jackson, he doesn't need it, but he's certainly got a Toshley to follow up, and this is an imposing board. Pimping Ho has used both of his qualities. He can't stop just a nonstop wave of big minions.
He can trade in the Bluegill Warrior, and he'd have two Bluegill Warriors and a War Leader. So he could clear the board with Anything Can Happen. With Anything Can Happen, number one.
Right.
But that's only three Murlocs.
Anything number two has to stick.
Oh, there was two War Leaders and only one Bluegill.
I don't know, man. He gave an opportunity for him to get another spare part for Lethal, but it's not it. Two Rusty Horns.
But
maybe if you fuse them together to do damage, they could do something.
The Beast.
Ah, you put him at one. You dropped the Beast.
Oh, man. Put him at one and drop the Beast. I think he dropped the Reno Jackson anyway.
I'm not against it either.
Both the qualities are gone.
Both the qualities are gone.
The
consecrations are gone.
Yeah. You just Rusty Horn both of them.
He's thinking,
also,
is there any possibility that I can throw this match by not playing defensive? And the reality is, too, if you taunt something up that has a lot, like, if you taunt up both of these minions, he can't even use, like, his weapon to get past things.
Yeah.
Right now, you're giving him a little bit of flexibility. Reno Jackson heals for 7, but it doesn't matter. It's a 4-6. Is this going to be the epic conclusion?
Dainey taking such a different approach to this matchup than anything we've seen across the tournament so far. Really applying the pressure.
Pimpingho is very much alive to a second Anything, too. I like it. Taunt everything.
Oh, man.
Keep Aviana alive. Pimpingho needs to draw a huge card here. And that's not it.
Anything will bring back two Bluegills now and two War Leaders. So I still think he can clear.
I believe you're right. He should be able to.
He will clear. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be...
It's gonna
with
be
a deck
one, yeah,
full of legendaries, can he find a way to deal one damage? One damage!
Or have a minion stick is the key as well.
Yeah.
And meanwhile, Peeping Ho will he'll have a couple of War Leaders remaining to pick apart the board.
All right, so he's got to think about this, because his Anything Can Happen will spawn two War Leaders and two Bluegills, so he won't have room for it all.
Wait, he also gets a 3-3. Does that cloud up his board too much? Oh, no, that's perfect.
He's still good.
Good. Yep. It's a lot of damage.
So,
I bet he wish he really had Deathwing right now.
Baron Geddon, Leroy Jenkins, Grom Hellscream.
King Crush
Deathwing
is my preferred tool of destruction. Antonitis. Oh, man.
And is he
so
dead?
Much damage on board.
He's dead.
He can't actually do anything.
Look at Pimpingo's face. He's like, please don't have one damage. Oh, thank you.
Just in case you guys don't know, when you cast a spell with Antonitis,
oh no,
you get a fireball. But also, when you're staring at over 50 damage, you also lose because you can't stop it. That's gonna wrap up game 3.
Wow, the biggest sigh of relief coming from Pimping Ho. What a match.
Dude, I don't even know what to say. The Paladin was on the verge of getting swept in the semifinals, but Pimping Ho survives by one health. One health. If Pimping Ho accidentally sneezed, he probably would have died that game.
Dan, maybe he is the chosen one.
You can't not win the series after that, right?
Yeah.
Oh, man, Dione is definitely crushed. You know what? I want to take a second to give props to Dione for taking such a bold game plan. I think a lot of people would just be like, well, I have Justicar. I coined it out. And I also, the Sludge Belcher and whatnot. I could just be really defensive and keep tanking up. But he says, I want to be really aggressive. And now here's the really excruciating thing. Did at any point in the game, Dowhini miss damage, TJ?
Miss one damage. Oh, man. If he loses this series, I know he's going to go back.
Should he have bashed face instead of bashed a zombie chow before playing Golden Monkey?
That's it.
It's so hard to say, but now maybe this has been the small opening that Ping Ping Ho needed to take the game in the series. What a fun day it's been so far. Some people are saying there's no way day three has good as good games as it does in day number one and two, because we've had some crazy, crazy matches, but I think it's living up to the billing.
I definitely say so. And, you know, Ping Ping Ho, we talked about it earlier. Ping Ping Ho has been around for a while. He's qualified for like four premier events, including the World Championship for 2015. But we've mentioned it a few times. He's never taken home that tournament win.
Can today be that day? I mean, he's qualified for a lot. And in a lot of ways, Ping Ping Ho reminds me of Osaka. Not necessarily in play style or even
personality at all.
Personality. It reminds me in the sense that he'd always qualify for events and then get eliminated very early.
Yeah.
That happened to Osaka a lot. Actually, even before Osaka qualified for events, he'd always be eliminated one round before the event, too. That was actually the popular inside joke within a lot of the pro players.
Yeah.
Guys like Osaka or a lot of his peers as well would struggle with that. Spo, for example, from SK Gaming.
Yep.
Like these guys, they're really good, and you might not have heard them. Martin Creek being another one. It's like, who are they? But they always get so close, and yet they fall just at the finish line. Ping Ping Ho has been that player, and I think he's on the verge of potentially getting to the finals, because that was a win that he needed to definitely shift the series in his favor.
All right, well, we're moving into Control Warrior once again. This time it's versus Demon Handlock, and Ping Ping Ho talking with him. He has a lot of confidence in this matchup, and
yeah.
I think rightfully so. But there's a couple of cards in Dione's deck that are a bit different than the rest of the field, with Sylvanas and Deathwing, which throw a couple wild cards. And I don't even know if Ping Ping Ho, I think that was the first time we've even seen the Deathwing, so I don't even know if Ping Ping Ho knows that it's in there.
Yeah, exactly. For all he knows, that was just another removal piece that got turned from a Golden Monkey card, sorry, a Warrior card to a Golden Monkey card.
Yeah.
Ping Ping Ho passes because he wants to play Mountain Giant first. However, he also can play Twilight Guardian and then Mountain Giant the following turn, too. He has a lot of flexibility with his plays right now. Twilight Drake does become a little bit stronger, but it will get Shield Slammed. So, this is kind of going back to the olden days of just making sure to space out your threats. If Ping Ping Ho coined out Twilight Drake the previous turn, he wouldn't actually be able to play anything on turn four.
Yeah. And this is sort of an age-old matchup, and I'm pretty sure Dan and I have casted this particular matchup hundreds of times, and we rehash the same concepts every time, but we're going to keep doing it for this one. It's all about, like you said, spacing out the threats as the Handlock player, and also being conservative with your removal as the Control Warrior player, because they have more threats than you have removal, so sometimes, you know, taking some extra hits with your weapons early on is okay. Making sure that you use executes when you have the activators and shield slams when you have the armors. There is a lot of technical things that go into this game.
Do you have the artifact? Yep, you're absolutely right, TJ. The reality of this matchup is that it'll heavily depend on who chooses to be aggressive first. And it oftentimes is the Handlock player, because they ramp up so aggressively. There's no way you can compete with a deck that plays an 8-8 on turn 4 or 4-10. However, cards like Execute and Shield Slam has kept Dahyoni safe enough, so now he can use cards like Sylvanas to help control state of the board. However, right now this Emperor Thorsen's pretty threatening. Probably just gonna have to use Fiery War Axe to stabilize, make sure he doesn't get too much value off of that card.
Yeah, the hand is okay for Ping Ping Ho to get reduced. Mal'Ganis, you can also fit like a free tap in with it. Hellfire reduced and being able to play free Mortal Coil can sometimes be okay. Draxxus is one of those cards that's really good to get reduced, and I think Ping Ping Ho, that's why he thought about it for a second. Maybe I can save it to get better value out of the mana reductions, but it's sort of just a luxury at this point, and it is a decent threat that has to be answered.
The real MVPs for Emperor Thorsen to reduce cost are the Taunt Givers, the Draxxus, like you mentioned, even cards like Sludge Belcher being really powerful too to squeeze in mana wise. Coin Mal'Ganis?
Whoa!
Ping Pimping Ho is so brave.
Yeah. I have no time for games.
Oh man, Daihoni is also greedy. He's gonna get punched by the RMB Cowl.
These are just some bold plays back and forth.
Wow. Yeah, I mean,
both of these guys came to the playground to throw down, Dan.
This Saturday night in Hollywood, California. And Ping Ping Ho, because he can get this damage in, now Daihoni has to pay twice the amount of life than he should have done. Yeah. However, I mean, he still feels pretty comfortable, I guess. The reality is Demon Handlock is still very much board-oriented. He's at 22. He still feels safe.
The thing is, he could have done this last turn. And I applaud the greed, because you can't just always play around now. You can't just always play around worst-case scenarios. Daihoni doing some
beautiful mind math calculations.
Yeah.
I don't understand it.
The numbers are just flying past his head.
Oh, Pimping Ho can Dark Bomb and shut down this Acolyte from drawing. Pretty decent draw.
Yeah.
You know, Pimping Ho also has a lot more board threats. When the Demon Handlock, it still plays the Void Callers. It gives up a lot of those early game consistencies, too. This is a deck that Life Coach has loved, Stan Sivka has loved, and they still play it even though it's bad in the metagame. However, Pimping Ho's making it work.
Yeah. It's bad in the general metagame, but it's extremely powerful in certain pockets. And this pocket that we have here, the Asia Pacific Winter Championship, with lots of control decks, lots of control warrior, is where the Demon Handlock can really shine.
Pimping Ho has an interesting dilemma. If he plays Dr. Boom, not only is Despite really effective against a board of almost all one health minions, he is playing into Brawl. However, he does have the Doom Guard, and that is legitimate burst to finish with Hellfire to end the game. So let's say hypothetically he does full damage, and then he's able to like pick apart his opponent a little bit more, then he can just end the game very quickly, and Daihoni's not expecting it, because he's like, oh yeah, you're a Demon Handlock, you're just going to be playing Jiraxxus, you're just going to be playing Giants and taunting them.
You can sort of get caught in.
I like this a lot. This is cute. He's not playing into Brawl. He's not playing into the Death by Strength. And he's
very
saying,
smart.
If you're going to attack, you have to take 5 damage.
Yep.
Of course, Daihoni still has a lot of opportunity to answer it. Chooses to override the Death Spite, which gives him the Whirlwind and the draw. I don't know how impactful the map to the Golden Monkey will be immediately, because in the end, I don't know if you want to lose Grommash. Some of the spells are really powerful against the Demon Handlock.
Yeah.
So Brawl, it'd still be one of the things that you would bide your time.
Yeah, Brawl especially, just because later in the game, a lot of times, with cards like Dr. Boom, and even after Jiraxxus is played with the Infernals.
It's true.
Hard to get rid of those. You just don't have the removal at that stage in the game to deal with threat after threat after threat. So you have to just let it build up and Brawl. But Daihoni can't really let threats build up, because after this Hellfire, it's going to be a 14 health.
Yeah, and if this Mountain Giant is able to land even one time, he's in trouble. Thankfully, he has that Sludge Belcher to introduce a blocking path. But in the event his opponent had a single Owl, he is dead. Pimping Ho smells blood. Oh, he's not dead. I apologize because of the armor up. Very astute observation there.
All right, so he could push 11. Well, no, because there's an Armorsmith on the board, so
okay.
Have to factor in the armor gain.
No Big Game Hunter either. That would have been a very clear opportunity to play Big Game Hunter.
All right, so these are the tough turns as the Demon Handlock, because you have a lot of threats in your hand. You still don't want to overextend onto the board, but you want to make sure that you're continuously applying pressure. Dr. Boom is a very risky card to play when you have anything else on the board, just because it makes you so susceptible to Brawl. So I'd imagine he's going to take a really sort of passive-ish play here. Maybe two creatures played, either a Heal Bot and maybe a Taunt Giver, a Molten Giant and a Taunt Giver, to try and play around Brawl as much as possible.
All right, plays a Molten, realizing that his hand's a little bit awkward, the Molten can be cheaper, but it might not get better than that. Plus, if he's anticipating a brawl, it needs to come out eventually.
All right, if he brawls here, he has three good outcomes, two being great,
yeah,
but two very bad outcomes.
He could also increase his chances by tossing another Armor Smith in. All right, well, here we go, the brawl. If a giant survives, it's bad news.
Uh-oh. The chosen one strikes again.
The good one, the bad one, the damaged one survives. We can shield slam it.
He still has to use a removal, but getting that full health taunted up Molten Giant out of the way is actually a really big deal.
It still stinks that you have to use the spell.
Yeah.
You could have kept it and had more flexible options.
Yeah.
And now Pink Ping Ho can go for the
Dr. Boom.
Indeed. Here's an interesting question too, though. How does he feel the flexibility to life tap?
Life tap would put him at 15. I don't know if Pink Ping Ho is confident enough in knowing the list of Dione to put him on not having some type of activator. But no matter what the activator would be outside of Cruel Taskmaster or Inner Range, which is crazy.
Right, right.
He would be safe even if he tapped. But he has the cards that he needs in his hand.
Yeah, I like it. I like just playing Dr. Boom so you can play outside of that range.
You want to get that. You want to try and get that second brawl out, but you still don't want to overextend into it too much. You have to find a balance.
I'm counting the damage to see if there's lethal for Pink Ping Ho in some capacity. I don't see it, though, because Daihoni is just slightly out of range.
And also, Armorsmith makes it a little bit awkward with Hellfire.
Right, right. It's true.
Huh? Ooh.
Well, you know, it's not awkward.
That's
Hellfiring that board. Not only can you Hellfire, but you can follow it up with Healbot and start doing other stuff.
And Voidcaller.
Well, you can
no, Hellfire. You can't put all that in.
You can Hellfire. Can you Molten and Healbot at the same time? You might be able to.
Depends on where the Boombots go.
Right. That seems very desirable. Assuming Boombots don't just ruin your day.
Yeah.
Okay. Because there is a chance that the Boombot kills Dr. Boom.
Ooh. Oh.
All right. I guess maybe the plans have changed.
So the Voidcaller, Draxxus is really important in this matchup.
Yeah, you're right. So I feel really good.
Putting out the Voidcaller, you know, just to be killed, just to soak up damage from Boombots and Hellfire is very risky. Now, having Draxxus on the board can also be a good thing later on in the game. Once all the removal is gone and brawls are gone, just because a 315 or, you know, 416, if it's taunted up by the Defender of Argus, can be really tough for a late game control ward to remove if all the removal has been expended. But at this stage, it's very risky.
Okay, what's the demon that gets getting pulled out here? Oh no, Draft scuffled out. All right, guess we're gonna have to fight this one without you. Well, I guess with you, but not the Inferno army. I mean, it is a hard minion to remove. It's 315, and if you can use Defender of Argus like you mentioned, pretty problematic. But you were counting on Drax as being one of the trump cards.
Dan, I don't know if I agree with that play. I'm unsure. I'm skeptical. Give me a thesaurus.
I'm waiting. You're not loving that play. Can you just get to the analysis part already, DJ?
Draxxus is such an important card in the late game stages of this matchup, especially now that the Warrior will always have threats at the end of the game because of the Golden Monkey. You need those Infernals to fight, and I just don't think the body of Draxxus is enough to be able to close out the game, because that's your sort of continuous win condition later on. Now he's got a finite amount of damage left.
You're right, although I will tell you that it's a lot of damage if you can get this Molten Giant underway. I do like the ability for Pink Ping Ho to start playing a little bit more aggressive on the board. However, Daihoni does have the brawl. Six cards remains in Daihoni's deck, and Pink Ping Ho looks like he has four or less. Three cards. And I think now that Draxxus got pulled out, I mean, the more I look at it, TJ, I think you're right. Which is, it's just, you know, first of all, you know, very impressive. Good job. The second thing, though, is Daehyun-ni. I mean, if that's his ticket to the finals, Pimping Ho might have just thrown it away. Still hard to say, though. But with a Brawl and a Deathwing to remove everything, I'm very skeptical.
Yeah, it was a risk. If Doomcard had come out, that would have been a very threatening board that Daehyun-ni would have had to deal with.
So Brawl has to land on the Molten Giant to really ruin Daehyun-ni's day. And Pimping Ho is going to hope that the Giant is the strongest. No! Doomguard! He is protected for now. But the fact that Pimping Ho lost his Taunt Giver too with the Defender of Argus means he's going to really need some help.
Oh, man.
He's going to need to get a lot of mileage, but the writing could be on the wall.
I just don't think it's going to be enough, Dan. I don't think it's going to be enough.
He can use the weapon just, or even use Growmosh. It's perfectly fine. He's just playing a game of keep away because he has the final say.
He has the Deathwing. He has the Golden Monkey.
Mm-hmm.
Unless the last couple cards in Pimpingo's deck are...
like Kodo Rider? Something absurd. No, you can't even do that.
A Kodo Rider?
I don't know. Something that generates infinite value. I'm trying to think of a substitute for the Inferno, but I'm not really seeing it. All right, Daehyun-ni, he's got Revenge, which doesn't really do anything. It's Deathwing time, and Pimping Ho, does he have any answer to it? No!
Did somebody say infinite value?
That's it. Daehyun-ni is the first finalist for the Asia Pacific Finals, fighting his way back and taking down the Chosen One. And Daehyun-ni is going to be able to overcome all the obstacles. He didn't finish first in his group at all, and he's upsetting a person who did win his group.
Yeah.
What a job well done here.
He also defeated Fate, apparently. Fate itself is what Pimping Ho said.
He said he felt like he was destined to win.
Yeah. So, but what a series that was.
Those are always the final words that someone says before they lose.
Yeah. What a series that was. Pimping Ho Games never failed to deliver. And now we can confidently say that Daehyun-ni Games never failed to deliver as well. And I'm looking forward to whoever he faces in the grand finals, as he will await for the next
series. Had it all, man. It had crazy emotions, a lot of wacky stuff happening. It had golden monkeys, which I can't wait to hear what Kibler says. But it also has a lovely dressed man named Doa standing by with Daehyun-ni, our first finalist in the Asia Pacific Winter Championship.
Well, do you know Daehyun-ni? What do you think? Do you think people know you now?
Do you know Daehyun-ni? 항상 말씀하시는데 이제 좀 다현이 선수를 아는 것 같습니까?
잘 모르겠는데 아직까지는 우승해야지 알지 않을까요?
He's not sure right now. I think if he wins, then everybody will know.
I think people are starting to know. So you finally got to play your warrior deck, and you finally got the golden monkey out. But the golden monkey kind of betrayed you in that first game. How did you feel after that happened? Do you feel like the warrior deck wasn't going to work, or was it okay?
드디어 그 전사 덱을 썼는데요. 그리고 황금 원숭이도 뽑았는데 그렇게 썩 좋은 결과는 아니었어요. 거기에 대해서 어떻게 생각하시나요?
원래대로라면은 마지막에 그 마법사 7코스트짜리 그 거대 화염 전차 같은 거 나와가지고 끝났어야 됐는데 오늘 좀 운이 안 좋았나 봐요.
She was expecting a Mage 7 cost card.
He wasn't expecting it.
Yeah, I suppose Antonitis probably isn't what you wanted to see there. So now you have two players that you might run into in the finals. It's either going to be Handsome Guy or Naviut. You've got a chance here to send a message to those two players. Let them know that Daehyun-ni is coming. What do you want to say to your possible opponents in the finals?
지금 이제 상대방이 두 명 중에 한 명이 될 건데요. 그 상대방한테 한 마디 좀 부탁드립니다.
서로 후회 없는 최선의 경기해서 누가 올라갔던 간에 축하해 줬으면 좋겠습니다. 감사합니다.
Let's do a match that we'll never regret, and whoever wins, I will be victorious in the end.
All right, I think it's going to be a great match either way. Let's go over to the sidebar where Papa Smithy, Kibler, and D2 are standing by.
Thanks very much, Doa. That was a really high-level series of Hearthstone, Brian Kibler and D2. First thoughts coming out of that one, because we now have our first finalist.
I mean, that was just a crazy match. We saw, you know, all sorts of various things going on in each side. You know, the series certainly didn't disappoint.
And D2, first takeaways, first impressions from, again, crowning our first finalist of APAC Winter.
Well, Brian Kim was going to put out a good face, but back on the side, I saw him almost literally pulling out his beautiful hair at the end moments there because of some of the decisions that were made. But overall, I did like the series. It was very entertaining, I'll say that.
So we'll have a couple of clips. Before we get to the first one, one of the big observations is we see more Murloc Paladin. We spent our last analyst desk or sidebar moment talking about Murloc Paladin. Some sequencing errors stood out from Pimpingho. It took him the 3 matches to pick up the first win with the Murloc Paladin. But I feel like the Warrior is where we started to see a lot of interesting plays, specifically Dionysus Warrior, because it's worth noting, this series was the first time that we saw Dione actually get to play as Warrior, and it wasn't what we were expecting.
Yeah, we actually had thought that based on the rest of his lineup that Dione would be bringing Patron Warrior. It looked like his lineup was well-suited to include that, but the Control Warrior was a bit of a surprise.
So let's get into our clips. We'll have our first replay coming out on the screen. And so given this situation, this is very late into the Murloc Paladin versus Control Warrior matchup. Talk to me, what's happening here, Kibler, and what are the big decisions that we have to take away?
Well, we've talked a bit about how the Control Warrior versus Murloc Paladin match can be won by the Warrior taking this extremely defensive line, using tank up over and over and over. However, Dione hasn't had that opportunity. He's taken a lot of damage, hasn't been able to build up a lot of armor. So he takes a very aggressive line and just goes to the face with his Grom and then decides to go with the Golden Monkey.
And D2, knowing that this isn't the removal warrior that we've been seeing, it's a control warrior, but certainly a different archetype, do you like the line he took instead of, again, holding on to Brawl, holding on to the Brawl and the Sludge Belcher and going for the more defensive line?
I do like the play that he made, considering what cards he had in his hand. He's basically going by what he could do, essentially, right? I mean, sometimes you have to pivot, even though there's certain ways that you win certain matchups. What he had in his hand, and his life total also, he just couldn't go for that line of play. He couldn't wait for Pimpingho to pick up the Murlocs. And his line of play actually ended up working out pretty well for him. Even though he lost that game in the end, he forced Pimpingho to be defensive, and that meant that the Anyfins Can Happen couldn't get their maximum value out of it. So I do like the play in the end. It really changed the kind of stance of the matchup.
Yeah, Hearthstone's all about playing to your outs. You like the fact that with Golden Monkey, he went for the all-in play. It was so close, one health away from picking up the victory there. But unfortunately for him, but fortunately for us, we got another game out of it. Another fantastic game. But honestly, it all seemed like it came down to one big decision from Pimpingho as we reload our second replay. Now, talk to me through this, Brian Kibler, because once again, this one seems really interesting, again, given the context of Dione's deck. Remember, though, viewers, they did not know that Deathwing was in this deck.
Yeah, this was the decision that D2 said that I was sort of pulling my hair out over. Pimpingho has the opportunity to just Hellfire away this board. He will lose his Dr. Boom here, but he decides to go with Voidcaller plus Shadowflame. He's hoping that Doomguard comes out here, but this is such a gigantic risk. Jiraxxus is absolutely your win condition in the late game, and ultimately, as the game played out, exactly what happens when you don't get Jiraxxus, he just ran out of threats and got fatigued.
And D2, I mean, the question the viewers probably wonder is, was he forced into a 50-50 there? Did he need to go for such an aggressive line, or was this just maybe just being overly worried when he looked pretty comfortable to some of us?
Yeah, absolutely not. I think that he didn't have to go for that play at all. He could have gone with the Healbot. I mean, even if he didn't get to a low enough health total to play Molten Giant and Healbot, I think it was fine because that's Control Warrior. They're not going to pressure too much unless they get the Golden Monkey. And even then, Jiraxxus, as we've mentioned multiple times, having those 6/6s every time is just too much tempo against all even the legendaries that Elise provides. So again, I just have to agree with Kibler here that it was just an unnecessary risk, and Jiraxxus is definitely your win condition in this matchup.
It went for the all-in, was punished for it. And guys, we'll begin our second semifinal to find out who will be facing Dione in that final. It'll be Handsome Guy versus Navi Ute right after these highlights.